We're going to go to the scriptures, and I'm so thankful for the Word of God that is provided for us. And there's so much that is found in here. And I need to share with you that this morning, as I was preparing for an upcoming Bible study, I was reading in one of the commentaries, and it talked about Jesus telling a pun. And I thought, I have never felt so vindicated in my life as right at that moment to see that Jesus tells puns. Because sometimes I get a little bit of pushback over my puns. And now, to be fair, when Jesus tells puns, they're not a vain attempt to be funny. They're to make a spiritual point. But I'll take what I can get, all right? I'm happy with that truth that's found there. But right now, no puns involved. We're going to look at Matthew 22, and I'm going to read verses 34 to 38. When the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. "Teacher, which commandment in the law is the greatest?" He said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the greatest and first commandment." God, we thank you for this passage. We ask that you would help us as we consider what we have just read, as we try to understand what it means for us today, as we look at the words of Jesus and his explanation of what he wants from his disciples. We ask that you would be present with us. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. What does Jesus want from us? We introduced that idea last week, and we saw that, first of all, Jesus wants us to follow him. That's the first step. But Jesus doesn't want just a bunch of people walking behind him. He wants people to follow in a certain way by doing certain things. And we can find throughout the Gospels indications of what Jesus wants. And what we're going to be looking at today is the first of basically a two-part mini-series within our larger series, in which we look at one particular incident that took place and what Jesus communicated about what he's looking for from his disciples. So the passage that I read to you, we have someone coming to Jesus and asking him, which is the greatest commandment? Now, that sounds like a pretty good question to be asking. I would think that if I had a time machine and I was able to go back into the earthly ministry of Jesus, and if I was able to speak to him face to face, I would want to ask a question like that. What is the greatest commandment? That sounds like a very good and perceptive question to ask Jesus. And yet, when we look at the context here, unfortunately, it doesn't look like this person is asking out of curiosity or a desire for personal growth, but rather this person is asking Jesus as a part of trying to trap him. And the passage right before, we have the Sadducees, they tried to lay a trap for Jesus. That didn't work. And so now we have the Pharisees stepping in, and they present a lawyer, and not in the modern sense of a lawyer, but someone who was knowledgeable about the law as found in the Bible, to ask Jesus, what is the greatest commandment? And the plan for this lawyer is that whatever Jesus asks, he's going to try to turn that around and suggest that, well, then you're, what you're saying is that this particular commandment is not as important, and then hopefully turn the crowd against him. That's the goal. That's what he's trying to do. But he's going to find that he's no more successful than the Sadducees before him. So he asks Jesus, what is the greatest commandment? And you would assume that Jesus would pick one of the Ten Commandments, right? When we think of the commandments that are found in the Old Testament, first thing that we think of are the Ten Commandments. And yet, Jesus doesn't choose one of the Ten Commandments. Instead, he quotes from Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 5, that talks about loving God. That you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. And this is a passage that would have been very familiar to the people who were listening. Because this isn't just a hidden gem somewhere in the Old Testament law. Rather, this verse here comes right after one of the most important verses for the Jewish people, both back then and today. And that is Deuteronomy 6:4, which is called the Shema, in which it says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one." And Jews back then, as today, will recite that verse every day in Hebrew, and they speak those words. And so they would have been very familiar with what happens right afterwards there when it says to love God. And so that's the next thing that we're looking at. What does Jesus want for us? Well, for one thing, Jesus wants us to love God. And that seems to be such a basic thing that, well, considering we have a potluck, why don't I just end the sermon right now and we can go and have our lunch? Well, we could do that, but I would like to just dig a little bit deeper and try to understand how we are to love God and how difficult it might be for us to love God. So, how hard or easy is it to love God? Well, I am sure that if we went around and talked to people, we would get different answers. There would be some people, probably some people here, who would say, loving God is really, really easy. Like, this is the easiest thing to love God. And you might be even surprised that I would even talk about people struggling with loving God. And I would think, and I can't say this for sure, but many of the people who would say that loving God is easy would be people who are able to see God's provision readily in their life. They see God's blessing. I'm not saying that they have a perfect life where there's been no suffering, no struggles at all, but in general, things are going pretty smoothly. And when they look at God's blessings in their life, they think loving God is easy. But what about those who don't have that kind of life? Those whose life is very, very difficult, where they are really wondering where God could be. Fairly recently, I read a memoir by a person whose parents both had survived the Holocaust. And when he talks about the experience of his Jewish parents in the concentration camps and the death of his grandparents in those concentration camps, this person who was born and raised Jewish but is not a Jewish believer today, he says very plainly that he cannot believe in God. And for him, it's not so much that he has looked at the evidence for the existence of God, but for him, as someone with a Jewish heritage, knowing that the Holocaust took place, if God does exist, he wants nothing to do with God Because why would God let his people suffer in such a terrible way? Moving even more recently, within my own lifetime, we think of the genocide in Rwanda, a terrible genocide where one tribe was seeking to wipe out completely another tribe. And there were even Christian pastors who were involved in that genocide, who not only didn't protect people, but were actively involved in seeking the death of the people in the other tribe. How does a Christian in Rwanda look at that, remembering what had happened, seeing supposed pastors participating in this, eagerly desiring the death of another tribe, and knowing that God allowed that? How does someone like that love God? When we bring it to a more personal level, so aside from genocides and Holocausts, what about a person who has just experienced something very difficult? So it could be the death or an illness of a loved one, especially of a child. How do you deal with that? Or what about someone who has been abused and abused repeatedly? How does a person like that love God? Because they're going to be asking those questions. Why did God allow that to happen? And so even if they continue to believe in God, they may find that they struggle with loving God. Well, I have a few things that I want to say to that. First of all, that we should have grace for ourselves and for others who experience this. Because when we look at the Psalms, very often the psalmist is complaining to God, God, why are you allowing this to happen? This is really hard. I am really struggling here. And there's not always within those Psalms a satisfying conclusion. It's simply the person complaining, saying this is really hard. We look at the book of Lamentations, which, yes, there's some positive things in there. We get the hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness, from that book. But if you look at most of the book of Lamentations, it is a complaint against God. And that seems to happen over and over again in the scriptures. So there is a place for us to feel this grief and even anger towards God when things are so, so bad. Now, I would say that at some point, we do need to put the blame where it belongs. That it wasn't God that made the Holocaust happen, or it wasn't God who made the genocide in Rwanda happen, or it wasn't God who insisted that this person abuse this other person. Rather, it is human beings who, in free will, are choosing to do evil. Now, most often, we can't make that leap right away. Most people have to spend at least some time struggling and wrestling with their understanding of God before they can get to that place. And we need to have patience. And then I would also say that we need to remind ourselves that love is not just a feeling. If we are waiting for us to feel that really intense love for God, that may take a long time. And a person who has really gone through a terrible time may never feel that again. But that doesn't mean that they don't necessarily love God. Have you ever been very, very angry with someone in your family? Someone that you know that you still love them, you still care deeply about them, but they have done something to hurt you that you feel intense anger. You realize you can feel both anger and love at the same time. And it's true for our experience with God as well. So how are we supposed to demonstrate love to God? And here's where I find that there is a major challenge for us in terms of how we demonstrate our love for God. And that is, there is a way that comes natural for each one of us. And very often in churches, we don't necessarily have a whole lot of patience for people who have a different way. We assume that what is most natural for us has got to be the right way. Because if I feel so strongly about this, if this is my conviction that the proper way to show love is this, I just can't imagine how someone could have a different opinion than that. And I have seen this over and over again. I have been in certain church circles that insisted that loving God was an emotional experience. And they really put aside any intellectual component to that. And not only would they say, you know, let's not even worry about the intellectual part, they would go so far as to say that intellectual part is actually kind of dangerous. If you expand your mind and your understanding about God and you study the scriptures too much and you learn too much about theology, your heart love for God is going to go down. And some of them would even say, you know, you should avoid theological training. Don't go to seminary or Bible college because you're going to lose your love for God. But I've also spent time in church circles that elevated the intellectual part. They would say loving God is all about loving God with your mind. And if you are one of those people who get a little bit too excited in church, you might raise your hands during a song, or heaven forbid, you smile during church. that's getting a little too emotional there. Got to be careful. Let's keep those things down because that will get in the way of the life of the mind. And so those two groups, and I've been a part of both of those groups at different parts of my life, would look at the other with a lot of suspicion to say that they are loving God in the wrong way. There have been times in my life where actually I have felt very discouraged in worship because my way of experiencing God was not necessarily what was going on in the church around me or with my group of friends, that I would have a different way. And so I thought I was failing in my love for God. And it really, I really understood this, and it really became clear to me when we had a couple of services at the church where Amanda and I actually met. And every once in a while, the pastor would announce during the service, I feel led by the Lord to not preach this morning, and we're just going to sing. That's all we're going to do for an hour and a half. And all my friends around me, they're like, yes, no sermon. We just get to sing. This is wonderful. And I'm like, oh, no sermon. We just get to sing. Great. And it wasn't the way I connected. Like, it's not that I was against singing, but I didn't feel a connection with God. I wanted to hear a exposition of the Bible. That's what I wanted to hear. And I realized that I was different from the people around me. And I thought it was because I was doing it wrong. And then I discovered that there are different ways for us to connect with God. And it all comes down to the fact that we are all created differently. We all have different personalities, different backgrounds, and what makes one person one way and another person another way doesn't mean that one is better than the other. So there are certain people who would just love to spend hours and hours singing hymns or newer Christian songs. They could spend 6 hours straight praying and they would just love it. That would just be something that would be so important to them. There would be others who would want to put their time into fighting for justice for the oppressed. There's other people who would want to be providing for the physical needs for the poor. There's people who would want to spend time in silent contemplation. Other people going around talking to strangers about Jesus, evangelizing and sharing their faith. And each of those people would feel so strongly about those things, they would wonder, why are people doing it different? Why would you want to spend 3 hours singing when you could spend 3 hours serving in a soup kitchen? Why would you want to be spending time out in creation for 3 hours when you could be taking that time and reading a theology book. They would look at each other wondering, why are you doing this? And people don't necessarily understand each other. But the point is, we are called to love God. And we have to love God in a way that is true to who God has created us to be. And we don't have to be like the other person. It's not as if one way is the only way in terms of how we love God, in terms of the kinds of things that I have been talking about here. One of the books that I have read in terms of human relationships is the Five Love Languages, and perhaps you have read that. It's what I use when I do pre-marriage counseling. Now, I always forget one of the five love languages, but they include things like physical touch and presence, like quality time, words of affirmation, gifts. And the fifth one is another one. acts of service. That's it. The fifth one's acts of service. And in that book, it talks about how each of us, when we show love to each other, there is a certain one that's going to feel most natural for us to do. And there's one that is most natural for the other person to receive. And interestingly, when we first went through this book, Amanda and I went through the listing here, and we were completely opposite, like completely. It was very, very interesting. The good thing is God receives love in all five love languages, and we have to realize what our love language is when it comes to God, and we need to invest in that and demonstrate that love in that way. Love the way we are created. So what does God want? God wants us to follow him, and we are to love God. Now, this is a realistic love. This is a love that takes into account our personalities and the way we are created. It takes into account our struggles, the difficulties that we have had in our life. It takes into account the fact that some people have had negligent parents, and it is so much of a struggle for them to reach out to God as their father because of the way they understand their human father. It takes into account all of that. It's the kind of love that recognizes that even Jesus on the cross would be able to say, my God, why have you forsaken me? If Jesus himself could feel God forsaken in that moment and yet not lack for love for the Father, then surely we can do it as well. You may be a thinker. You may be a feeler. You may be a doer. It doesn't matter. We all have to love God. Now, that doesn't mean that we don't stretch ourselves and try to do these things. As I said, singing is not necessarily the way that is most natural for me to demonstrate my love for God. And yet, I sing the hymns. I sing the songs. And I do these other things, even though they might not necessarily be completely natural for me. But I also try to live in the way that God has created me. We need to embrace who God has made us, and in such a way, we are to love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our soul, and with all our mind.